Hello, welcome back. Welcome to Insect Pests of Crops lecture series. In the lecture number 3, I'll be dealing with the pests of maize. So because number of pests needs to be discussed, I have divided this lecture into 3 classes. Under lecture 3A, under this class, I'll be concentrating on the borer pests. In the remaining 2 lectures, I'll be dealing with the defoliator pests under 3B. In 3C, aerid or cob and sucking pests. Okay, so under this lecture number 3A, I'll be dealing with the pests of our maize as borer pests. Okay, so there are a number of borer pests, but now I'll be concentrating on the 3 borer pests. Shoot fly, there are a number of Atherigona species, which may be Atherigona sacchata, Atherigona nuckvi, Atherigona proximata, like that. There are a number of species which infest the sorghum in general, but other millets, rice are also in fact worst for shoot fly. Whereas pink stem borer and white stem borer are the major pests. Okay, so pink stem borer, Sesamia inferens, and white stem borer, Calopartillus, are considered as very serious pests of maize throughout India and other Southeast Asian countries, wherever the maize is grown. Coming to the first pest, shoot fly, Atherigona species. It belongs to family Musidae of Diptera. Sorghum is the preferred worst, but rice, wheat, maize, millets, and various wild grasses also acts as worst for this insect. Coming to distribution, in fact, it is mainly African and Asian species. Okay, so in Europe, it has been reported only from Italy, whereas Africa, it is widely distributed. In the case of Asia, India, China, Bangladesh, Indonesia, and Philippines. Okay, so most of the Southeast Asian countries, it is distributed. Coming to nature of damage, once the maggot hatch from the eggs, which are generally laid on the undersurface of leaves, they bore into the shoot of young plants. Okay, young plants of about a week to 1 month old crop. Okay, so they get into the stem and they start boring. Okay, once they bore the stem, okay, so that part actually starts decaying. As a result of that, the plants dries up. And that typical symptom wherein the central shoot dries up is called dead art. Okay, that dead art symptomatic plants, you can clearly see here. Okay, such symptomatic plants can be easily pulled off. Okay, it easily comes off when it is actually pulled, because that portion actually, wherever it is, it has bored, the maggot has bored, leads to decaying and death of that tissue. Okay, so the dead art is the very typical symptom caused by this shoot fly. So generally they lay 1 egg per plant. Okay, so they do not lay more number of or multiple number of eggs in a single plant, so that the maggots will not become competitive. So they don't compete on another and feed on that individual plant. So if, as I was telling, that usually the plants of 7 to 30 days old crops are susceptible. Even sometimes the more than 30 day old crop may be attacked and leads to dead art. But what happens in such mother plant, the side shoot appears like this, you can see here. Okay, but these side tillers may also get infestation. Okay, so that's how it becomes problematic. The most vulnerable stage of the crop is being up to 60 days. So more than 60 day old crop is not preferred or attacked by the shoot flies. And especially in the years of high rainfall, there will be very high incidence. Okay, so those years you'll get maximum incidence, more incidence. And ETL of this pest is 10% dead arts. Coming to life history of shoot fly. Okay, so adult is a small grayish fly, which lays about 40 number of eggs. Single egg is laid per plant, which are white, cylindrical, somewhat flattened distally. Okay, which hatch in 1 to 3 days. Okay, and maggots, duration takes about 8 to 10 days, and they usually migrate to the dorsal surface of leaf, enter the space between the leaf sheath and bore the central shoot. Okay, so from the ventral surface, it moves to the dorsal surface and get into the central shoot, and there it starts feeding. That's how it causes the damage. And pupate within that stem, okay, the pupation takes about 7 days. That is the life history of Atherigona species. Coming to IPM of Atherigona, so higher seed rate is adopted, because as I was telling, the infestation is generally from 7 to 1 month old crop. So if you increase the seed rate, even if the few number of plants get infested, which can be easily removed, so that the sufficient population is maintained per unit area. Okay, so that we can increase the seed rate, 12 kg per acre. Usually in case of maize, 8 to 10 kg is more. I use it as seed. So if you increase the seed rate, even if the infestation occurs in few of the plants, you can just remove those infested plants so that minimum or sufficient number of plants per unit area is maintained. So then you can go for seed coating with chlorpyrifos 4 ml kg or monocrotophos at the rate of 4 ml per kg of seed. So you can coat the seed with insecticide so that it can give the protection up to 30 days. Then application of forate or carbapuran at the rate of 40 kg per hectare or about 3 gram per meter row. So when you do the sowing, after sowing, you can go for application of these granular insecticides. So only thing is that you should take care that you will not mix the insecticide with the seed directly, this granular insecticide, so that otherwise the germination get affected. Pull out the plants showing deadheads and destroy at the time of thinning, so that minimum number of plants which have to be maintained per unit area will remain same. Set up Yanging type fish meal trap at the rate of 12 per hectare. So fish attracts the flies. Okay, so that can be exploited in order to manage these insects. So it can be done up to 30 day old crop. So I will show you how to set up this fish meal trap. Or else you can go for spraying cypermethrin or carthophytochloride. If it is cypermethrin, 1.5 ml per liter. Carthophytochloride at the rate of 2 ml per liter or triazophos 1.5 ml per liter. Twice you have to go for spraying. 1 week after the sowing, another is second week. Okay, wherever the incidence will be very high. The years of high rainfall may require insecticidal spray depending on the ETL level. So as I was mentioning, so fish attracts the flies. So you can go for setting this fish type of fish meal trap. What we have to do, the fish meal powder has to be mixed with 2% starch and it has to be mixed with a little quantity of hot water so that it acts as a sticking agent. You need to add about 50 gram of melathion powder so that it can be properly mixed and placed inside the container which contains number of holes. Okay, so they get attracted and eat on this fish meal and they die off. Okay, so it can be yanged at the rate of 12 traps per hectare in the field. Okay, so very good method. So coming to the second very important pest is the pink stem borer Sesame inferens, belongs to family Noctuidae. So preferably it attacks maize and sorghum, also attacks finger millet, pearl millet, rice, sugarcane and various wild grasses. And this insect Sesame inferens is mainly Asian and Australian species. You can see here most of the Asian countries are this insect is found, even in Australia. Okay, so mainly Asian and Australian pest. Coming to nature of damage, so the larvae is the damaging stage when it feeds. Okay, the eggs are usually laid between the leaf sheath and the larvae enters through the unopened leaf and get into the stem. Okay, so as a result of the feeding on those unopened leaves, okay, elongated holes, you can see here, elongated holes are found on those opened leaves, unfurled leaves. Okay, when the leaves opens up, you'll find this type of window holes, large window holes, you can see here. So then they get into the main stem and then start boring, you can see here. Okay, so as a result of that, dead dot occurs. Okay, so dead dot occurs even in case of shoot fly. Then how is the difference? Okay, so the difference is that it infests, the Sesame inferens infests the crop a month old to year end stage, up to cob. Even the cob is attacked by this Sesame inferens. So that's how we can differentiate usually. So the first month is by shoot fly, and afterwards it must be due to Sesame inferens. Of course, can see this type of very important symptom, elongated holes, okay, which is not found in case of shoot fly, of course. So ETL again 10% dead dots, economic threshold level. Coming to our larval and adult identification characters, you can see the larva is pinkish, okay, with dark head, okay, so pinkish colored with a series of black spot, you can see here, you can easily recognize. And adult's forewings are straw colored and there is a black stripe in the middle running from base to apex like this. Okay, hind wings are entirely cream colored. Okay, so that's how you can differentiate larvae and adults. Coming to life history, the adult lays the eggs in the leaf sheath, you can see here. Okay, so eggs about 106 to 277 eggs may be deposited by single female, and the period is about 10 to 14 days. Okay, and the larval period is 21 to 37 days. And now it is the stage where it diapause sometime. Okay, may now takes longer duration during the larval stage. So within the stem, okay, where it is feeding, and pupation occurs within the stem. So it pupate for about 12 to 14 days. Okay, so pupation occurs within the stem. So very important thing to be noticed, because many times, so the life history, the management strategy is designed based on the life history. Okay, so this is the life history of Sesamia inference. So coming to white stem borer, spotted borer, which is also called, okay, Caelopatylus. So we will discuss the management of Sesame inference and Caelopatylus at the end. Okay, the management aspects of both of these borer pests is same. So again, maize and sorghum are the preferred hosts. Finger millet, rice, sugarcane, and other wild grass are also attacked. You can see the distribution here. So again, this species is also mainly African and Asian species. Okay, you can see here. So even it is found in Australia. Coming to nature of damage, feeding of young larvae. Again, you can see tender folded leaves causing typical small sized holes. Okay, pin holes are found, shot holes are found. So compared to Sesame inference, where you find the elongated window holes. Okay, so that's how we can differentiate the feeding damage by the Sesame inference and then the Caelopatylus. Whereas the dead art is common in all the three species. Okay, so such dead art plants, symptomatic plants can be easily pulled out. Okay, so it infests the crop a month or to arid stage usually. So like Sesame inference, it also infests the cobby one. Okay, so VTL is again 10% dead arts. So coming to larval and adult identification character, you can see here there will be number of spots, black spots on the body of this white colored larvae. That's why it's called, also called spotted borer. Say white stem borer, also called spotted borer. Okay, whereas the adult, the four wings are straw colored with black dots at the apical end. You can see a series of black spots, but in case of Sesame inference we are discussing, there is a black patch in the middle of the forewings, whereas end wings are cream colored. Okay, so that's how we can identify the larvae and adult of Caelopatylus. Coming to life history, the adult is, as I was telling, it lays about 200 to 300 eggs in the leaf sheath again. So whereas the eggs of Sesame inference, you can see they are oval, but here the eggs are flat. Here also eggs are laid in the leaf sheath, but eggs are flat, which takes about 2 to 6 days as incubation period. And you can see here the duration of the larval stage is actually longer depending on the season. In case of summer, winter season, it takes long period because they hibernate in the larval stage. Whereas summer takes about 28 to 50 days. Whereas the pupation occurs within the stem, which takes about 7 to 15 days. Coming to IPM of both Sesame inference and Caelopatylus. Okay, so both the species management is similar. Collection and destruction of the stubble which are left in the field, because pupation occurs there itself and larvae will be there many times. So such has to be destroyed. Okay, otherwise they may complete the life stage and attacks the other crop, because they also breed in various wild grasses. Very important cultural strategy is sowing lablab or cowpea, field bean or cowpea as an intercrop to minimize stem borer damage at the ratio of 4:1. For every 4 rows, 1 row of field bean or cowpea has to be sown. Okay, so intercropping actually reduces the incidence. It actually changes the micro environment and reduces the infestation. So collection and destruction of dead art symptomatic plants, set up light trap and sex pheromone trap to attract and kill the moths. Okay, various commercially, these sex pheromone traps are commercially available. They can be exploited, utilized for the management of these two pests. So then the management strategy, very well known traditional management strategy among the farmers is two rural application of 4% cut of hydrochloride granules or carbofuran granules has to be placed at the rural region. So it may be first rural application may be at the rate of 5 kg per hectare when the crop is 25 to 30 days old. Second at the rate of 10 kg, 10 to 15 days later. So generally incidence get reduced after that. But if the infestation persists, again, we have to go for at the rating of 5, 7.5 and 10 kg per hectare has to be applied in the woods. Okay, so that's how we can manage these two pests. Okay, so the question is how to, when you visit a field, how to diagnose these three borer pests, Atherigona, Sesamia, and Caelopatylus. So generally, the occurrence of these Atherigona and Sesamia differs. So 1 week to 1 month old crop, whereas usually these two borer pests, 1 month afterwards the infestation starts. The symptoms occurs are no borer holes may be visible in the dead art plants. Okay, but in both the cases, sesame and kylo, you'll find the bored balls. So then how do you distinguish sesame and kylo cotyledons? You'll find the extensive stem tunneling and the presence of yellowish jelly material inside the leaf sheath. Okay, so wherever it is actually bored, you'll find this yellowish jelly material. Whereas in case of kylo cotyledons, stem tunneling damage by the kylo cotyledons is seen with the dried up waste material. Lot of waste material get accumulated. Their flask get accumulated, which usually dries up very fast. So that's how we can distinguish the sesame and kylo cotyledons. So I'll show the photographs, you'll better understand this. You can see here. So yellowish jelly material get attacked, found in the leaf sheath. Okay, in case of sesame inference, whereas you can see this flask get accumulated, dried up waste material get accumulated in the leaf sheath region. So that's how we can differentiate the damage of sesame and kylo cotyledons. Okay. So before ending, I have few questions. What is the diapausing stage of kylo cotyledons? Okay, so go back and check. How to differentiate kylo cotyledons and sesame inference larvae? So kylo cotyledons is called a white stem borer or spotted borer, whereas sesame inference is called pink stem borer. Okay, so I think you will get the answer. Which species it is? Can you see this series of dark spots in the apical region? Okay, which species it is? Go back and check. So what is the IPM strategy for stem borer pests of mice, which we discussed at the end? Okay, so get ready with these questions. Okay, so thank you very much. If there are any questions, you can post below or you can email me as well. So thank you very much.